गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज द सेवेंथ वीडियो ऑफ द चैप्टर नेशनलिज्म इन यूरोप एंड इन दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस मेनली द कल्चरल मूवमेंट एंड द हंगर हार्डशिप एंड पॉपुलर रिवोल्ट. हियर वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट इन यूरोप इन द ईयर 1830 इन द ईयर 1830 टू 48 इट वॉज द ईयर ऑफ रेवोल्यूशनरी. In that particular period, the revolutionary became very strong and they demanded for removal of monarchy from the European countries. Meanwhile, one more movement was going on. Apart from the struggle, apart from the war, apart from the revolutionary, one more movement was going on in the Europe at that time, and it was the cultural movement. And it was known as Romanticism. So basically, Romanticism was nothing but a cultural movement that started in Europe in order to unify the different people together. Now, what was there in the Romanticism? It was a cultural movement that focused mainly on the artists, poems, poetry, different type of literature, and all these were used to unify population of Europe. Here, I would like to take one name, that is Johann Gottfried. And he mainly focused on the folk stories. He told clearly that citizen of Germany, because he was mainly from German, citizen of Germany, and Germany was the area at that time, it was the region. He told clearly that Germany, that is the region. Germany, the people of Germany are the real carrier of nationalism. It is only through the people of Germany the nationalism can be carried forward. So here you have to understand that Johann Gottfried focused mainly on the ordinary people, and he focused on the folk stories, folk tales, folk dance, and he tried to take the attention. He tried to take the attention of ordinary people in rising the nationalism or rising the national spirit of nationalism. So this is how the nationalism erupted in Europe. Apart from that, the most significant element was the language, and particularly the vernacular language. So language was the one important tool that was used to connect people of Europe, particularly the vernacular language or the local language. So local languages are utilized to connect the various people together, people who are not knowing each other and they were living in different regions, because we already discussed that people in Europe were under the domination of different kings. Even the same area, even the same state or region was ruled over by several kings, and several kings were ruling over the different parts, and different people were under the command of different kings. But what was common? The common was the vernacular language. Suppose I am going to take the name of German region. So German region was subdivided into more than 100 pieces. And finally, as we discussed, that it got converted into 39 confederation. But still, the different languages were there, the different you can say currencies were there, and finally we discussed about the Jalbari. Because of that, the language, the currency that was there, it became less. Now, what was the common thing in the German region? It was the language. I mean, people came together, they got unified because of the language only. So language was very important element in unifying the people of that time. Now, apart from that, we'll have to understand one more thing, that when Vienna Congress held, in that meeting, most part of the European areas were distributed among the powerful kingdoms. Like Poland was given to Russia, and some part of Poland was given to Russia, some part of the Poland was given to Austria, some part was given to the Prussia. So this is how the entire Poland area was distributed among powerful kingdoms. But still, the people who were distributed among different kingdoms, what was common? What was common thing? The common thing was that they got connected through the language. I mean to say, the part of Poland that was under the Austria, the part of Poland that was under the Prussia, or the part of Poland that was under the Russia, they all were having different kings, different domination. But still, the people living in all the different kingdoms were connected with a common language. That was Polish language. So Polish language became the carrier of nationalism. It became the most important cementing material for promoting the nation, for promoting the idea of nationalism. You must understand that when Russia got occupation over Poland, or Russia occupied the Poland, it abolished the Polish language from the Russia, and the member of, or the people of Poland were not allowed to talk in Polish language. So this was done in order to popularize the Russian language in place of Polish language. But people were very repulsive there, and they were not ready to accept this. And that is why the different clergy, different groups, they assembled in a church and they used Polish language to popularize their ideas, for popularizing the religious themes. So you have to understand that Polish, despite the domination of Russia, the Polish language remained static. It remained very strong, and it could not be wiped out very easily. And that is why, again, Poland got independence, and now you can see Poland is a country. So you have to understand, because the language withstand the pressure of other kingdoms, and language became the most important part in Europe to unify public together. And because of that, nationalism erupted and finally developed. So we discussed that in Europe, apart from the mass struggle, apart from the territorial expansion, one more movement was going on, and that was the cultural movement. And cultural movement demanded for poetry, it demanded for literature, it demanded for language also, and all these became very important vehicle for the nationalism. Now we are going to discuss the second segment, that is hunger, hardship and popular revolt. We already discussed that Europe confronted many revolts, because from 1830 to 48 it was the time of revolutionaries. So in all parts of Europe, revolutions were going on. Here you have to understand that in 1830 and 1848, in both the years, Europe was facing problem because of the growing population. Food scarcity was there. And apart from that, migration also started from the village towards towns. And because of that, the pressure was increased on the cities. So this was the time when, with the growth of population, unemployment was also increasing. Apart from that, people were facing much problem because of the monarchs. They were ruling in this period also. But at the same time, cultural movement was going on, and revolutionary war also going on in full swing, and they were not ready to accept the domination of monarchs. So you have to understand that hunger was there, hardship was there, and it led to the popular revolt by the weavers or the peasants. So basically in this period, the peasants and laborers and the weavers, they started the revolt against the contractor. It is mentioned in your book that Silesia was a particular place in which the peasants revolted against the contractors. They attacked their houses and they completely wiped them. So what it is showing? It is showing that people were very frustrated with the present regime, with the European regime, and particularly the coming comeback of conservatives. So this is how the period of 1830 and 48, it was the period of revolution. And in this period, two important things happened. First was the cultural movement erupted, and second thing was the hunger, hardship got chance to develop, and finally it led to the popular revolt. Here I would like to add here that the Louis Philippe, that was a constitutional monarch that was established by people at the time in 1848. Finally, because of the food scarcity, people came on the street and they kicked out the Louis Philippe from the country, and completely monarchy ended in this period. From 1830 to 48, it was a period of revolutionary, and they put all their efforts to kick out the monarchs or conservatives from the European area. Now come to the question. The question is, what do you understand by the idea of Romanticism? So basically, Romanticism is a cultural movement that includes the mystic feelings, imagination, poetic versions, and use of different symbols, languages, to bring about the idea of nationalism. So like this we can discuss that in the Europe two type of movement was going on. One was the mass struggle or the revolution, other was the cultural movement, and one more thing you can add that started initially, that was the territorial expansion as it was started by Napoleon. But mainly two was there. First one was the revolutions or the mass struggle, and second one was the cultural movement. So this is all about in this topic. Thank you so much.